Okay, it's on. Okay.
You may begin.
Okay. Hi, my name is Carrie Williams. I'm a senior here at McKinney Boyd High School. And just a little bit about me really quickly. I'm going to be attending Furman University next year. I'll be majoring in politics and international affairs. I'm hoping to continue my cheer career there, but I haven't quite found out about the team yet. And yeah, so this year I studied international relations and foreign policy. And so my goals for ISM is I was just really trying to figure out if this is something I wanted to do with my life. Basically, am I interested in this? Is there actually a way that I can find what I want to do under this topic? Because international relations is a really broad umbrella. So I was just trying to make sure I could find something I enjoyed under this umbrella, because where I started this, I just really love traveling and I really love helping people. And I thought this was the best way to combine those together, because international relations, you get to deal with sending aid to different countries, trying to help with wars, that sort of thing. And it's in different countries, so you can travel inherently. And then also, one big thing is, can I have a family in this job? I'm a very family-oriented person. And so what's really important to me is, if I'm going to be traveling to a different country every 3 weeks, then, you know, that's not quite as feasible for a family. But if I'm stationed in a country, if I'm stationed in America, but go to a different country 1 week in a month or something, that's more feasible for a family. Just basic information like that. And then my quotes, they're both by John F. Kennedy, and they both basically talk about just putting aside partisan issues and just really coming to work together bipartisan to just fix an issue, and just forgetting that I'm a Republican, so I'm not going to think this way about your thing, or I'm not going to reason with you because you're a Democrat, and just saying, here's the issue, here's the obvious solution, I don't care what the party's going to say about it, because this is how we help the solution. So I'm just going to go with it and just not worry about anything else, which is something that I think is really admirable, because in today's age, we've gotten so, our identity is so much in our parties for a lot of the point with politicians, and I just think that's not how they were intended to be, and so we need to go back into the way of, obviously there's going to be parties because people are going to differ on things and there needs to be a platform for that, but at the same time, when we need to make a decision and we need to make a law or a bill, it can't just get in stalemate every time because there are Democrats, so I'm not going to vote that way, in other words. So my research information, I had a bunch of different research, and these were some of my top ones. Basically, the first one is just talking about more of the electioning side and becoming a politician, and it's just talking about, can you afford to be a politician, is what it's called. It's people will save all their money, live on half of their income until the time they're 45, then start a political campaign, spend all of the money that they saved, still not get elected, and now have no job and be broke. And so it's kind of a cautionary tale to people interested in politics, to just really know if you can do this, if you have the money for it, and if you have the support for it. Because even if you have savings, you're going to need support from other backers who will give you money as your savings start to run out, because that's inherent as you spend money. The next one, nationalism is back. This started my idea for my project, and so that was the main thing I was just talking about. In this day and age, everyone's becoming nationalistic country-wise, and so we're being isolationist, and just how that affects the international relations and the politics and the policies of different nations.
You want to take a time out?
Sure.
So you're only the second person this has happened with. I've started and then the bell rang. I've tried to be real strategic. So when you're re-watching it, you'll just want to fast forward through that part. Yeah. Because so if I pause it,
then
it's
going to
end.
Yeah.
So, and you can't do that with QuickTime.
Don't Stop Believing came on, everyone was singing in the hallway, and it was so distracting, because I'm trying to think in Spanish, and there's this jamming song, and I'm like trying to listen to this audio section in Spanish. It was wild.
How many people took AP Spanish?
Well, because this one was just language, and so there's about 15 of us. It's just my class. And then Liv was yesterday, but Spanish class. It's like Sammy took it.
because of the bell.
Yeah.
Add it to your stack. I won't be open today.
One more person.
Marcus.
I think what happened was I had their number, but I only had it because I had added them to a GroupMe chat. So they had never gotten any texts from me. So I guess they didn't recognize my number. And they're like, is this creepy person asking for my address?
So did you write back and say, this is Marcus?
No, I messaged them through GroupMe and apologized for the confusion.
Okay, thank you. Hi.
Hi.
Continuing on with my research, my third piece of research that was most important was called How to Get a Job in the Foreign Policy World. And this one, I would say, was my most informative research about the job side of it, and not necessarily policy side or specific information, but more on like how to get a job, because it just talked about all different ways you can get a job, all different types of jobs, and it's not just I'm a politician or I'm a diplomat. You can work for nonprofits, you can work for international companies. And like this author, he worked for a think tank, and that he would help inform different representatives and different congressmen and about a bill or an issue that they were going to need to vote on, which I thought was really interesting. And then the last one was basically an interview. It was actually an interview on YouTube, so I was able to watch that, and it was really interesting. It was about this guy who, he works for the UN undersecretary, and so he was just talking about how to get into the UN, what the UN is like, kind of how the UN operates, and that was really interesting because I've always kind of wanted to be in the UN, just because I think that would be cool, but he mentions how hard it is for Americans to get into the UN.
I'd say it's cool.
Sorry. It's really, what would I say instead?
No, it's cool.
Yeah, you put it on my last one too. I still just don't know. I don't have that high of a vocabulary. Anyway, so one thing he recommended is possibly if you are an American to go and live in a different country for a while and be a resident of a different country and try to join the UN through that country, which I thought was interesting because I definitely want to live abroad, and so that's a good way to live abroad while working on furthering my career at the same time. So then interviews, over here on my poster board is a more full list of all the interviews I've had. I still left a couple off of people who just end up not being as informative as I thought they were going to be. So, this is just, I had a plethora of interviews this year, which was great because last year I didn't have as many interviews. So we really kind of flipped the tables, which is really nice. And so they're kind of in order of most helpful to least helpful. So we can come over here. I highlighted my most helpfuls. And so Miss Eldridge, she was super helpful, not with my product, but just on the field and on careers you can have. She worked in Albania and Algeria, helping rebuild their government and teaching democratic principles after the communist regimes fell, which I thought was super, super interesting and just a totally different way, because almost everyone else who I interviewed were all professors. And so it was different to have someone who had that hands-on experience. Next, I have Professor Wagner, and I actually interviewed with him twice, one about the career side of things and one about my product. And the career side was just super amazing. It was really encouraging and just focused on life advice and how to just don't be stuck in what you think you want to do and go into college open-minded and take every opportunity you can, because you never know where you're going to end up or what's going to influence you. And he used to sell fish for a living. And then he went to Rice, Oxford, and Harvard. And so it's this huge array of things that he's done, and just says he would never change anything that he did. And then when I talk about my product, he was mainly thinking about focus on how the policy is going to come back and affect the whole nation, because whenever you think of international policy, you think of how's it going to help the nation that we're intending to help, and not what repercussions could possibly face the home nation. And then lastly is Professor Strauss, and he was one who I ended up honoring tonight because he helped me so much with my project. And he basically gave me the idea that I ended up going with. I kind of had a really basic version of this in my head coming into the year, but he was able to really just make it a lot more intelligent and really make it flow into what I actually wanted it to be. So now my plans for my project, as you can see with this map, this is what I ended up doing. And so I have the different push pens for the different locations of places that I've done my research papers on. And so there's four topics. There's four countries. There's Russia, China, the US, and the European Union. And then there's three topics, which are immigration, war, and humanitarian crises. And so I was just able to just really do just an intensive research paper on what the policy was, how it affected the country, the home country of the nation that hosted the policy, and then just how it, some of them, especially for the U.S., I did more case studies over time, just with how the different administration has changed things throughout, since Trump just got elected within the last year and a half now, just how it used to be and how it is now. Can't really say what's right and what's wrong because it's only been in effect for about a year, but just analyzing the different stances. And then my mentor, again, I ended up having, not technically having a mentor, it kind of fell through a little bit. Professor Strauss was going to be my mentor, but then he ended up not having time anymore. I just found that out last weekend, which was awesome. But anyway, he helped me a lot with my project still, so that's really great. So then why I picked these government systems? So Russia, I picked them because they're all set up similar, but they all come from such different backgrounds of different used to be communist regimes, and then the America, which is about as of a republic as you can get. And then the European is so different because it has so many different independent nations within it who are still set on working together to find a common ground to help the world as best they can. And so I just thought these were really interesting, and they're becoming the major players in this era because they do have the most power. So my specifics for refugees, so I'm going to go and talk briefly about why I picked each of my themes. And so for refugees, one in every 113 people is considered either a refugee or an internally displaced person or an asylum seeker, which just is insane to me because of how many people there are in the world. And you just think about there's about 8 billion people in the world, so you can do math, and there's a lot of people who just aren't in their town based on actions that they didn't make themselves, which is just, it's like, it's really humbling. Just like, I lived in the same place for all my life, and a lot of these people have moved at least 5 times, some even 10 times, just trying to run from people trying to kill them, or just trying to find clean drinking water and food to eat. And it's just, it's really humbling. And so ones that I looked at were the civil war in Syria, and just because this is the biggest creation of refugee crisis that this world has ever seen in the last, I think ever actually, but just under 5 million people displaced in just 6 years. Which, if you think about, you look at the world, or the war, it doesn't seem like it's coming to an end anytime soon, and every year it's exponentially increasing how many more refugees there are created through this crisis, and so it's just going to be interesting to look into the next few years how that's going to change, if it's going to keep increasing, or if eventually someone's going to step in and be like, this isn't okay, we're going to help, we're going to fix this. And another interesting fact about this is that most of these refugees are remaining in the Middle East, and then the second place they go is Europe. And so just because it's kind of a hot button topic in America of refugees and refugees from the Middle East and how it's going to affect our nation when we don't even have the highest percentage of refugees trying to come to us. And then the second thing I looked at was displaced people migrating through the Mediterranean Sea. So around 4,000 people die crossing the Mediterranean Sea every year. Just, again, they're refugees, so just escaping famine, poverty, war, whatever it may be. They're just getting on these little motor-powered boats, going across roaring seas and everything, just trying to find a better life. And once they get there, a lot of them are still rejected and turned around and sent back to their home country, and then have to cross the Mediterranean again. And so it just increases the deaths. And again, the deaths have been increasing every year. So it's just something to continue looking at through everything we're going through. So then for war, I have up there that global awareness starts when you understand the true issues of every country, which I think is just something that people forget, that you can't say, I know what's going on in the world, if you truly know about the dispute over Kashmir, if you know about the Venezuelan civil war, just how everything's so interconnected these days that a small dispute somewhere can erupt into World War III. And so, like I just mentioned, there's a dispute going on in Kashmir, which is this little up here, this little stripy area, and between Pakistan and India. Currently, India claims ties to the land, and it's technically considered a part of India. However, Pakistan also claims ties to most of that because of ethnic groups that are Pakistani in Kashmir. So it's just different to look at just how the war is going and how people really are trying to stop the war. They're just trying to mediate between the people, which is interesting. And then the Venezuelan civil war, obviously they used to be major oil players until economic crisis hit. And now there's basically stagflation, so there's a very, very high unemployment percentage, and there's a very high inflation percentage, so the Venezuelan currency basically buys you nothing, mm-hmm. and it's about the same as dirt, and people are burning money for fires to warm themselves in the winter instead of spending money because it's so useless, which was unimaginable. Then lastly, I have a humanitarian crisis, which, I mean, just looking at these pictures, I don't know how your heart can't be stirred and how you don't want to try and help. And so I really have a heart for people and a heart for children. And it's just something I've always cared about and something I've always wanted to work with. And so one of the first things I was looking at is the genocide of Rohingya people in Myanmar. And it's one of those things that the Secretary of State, I believe it was last month, classified it as an ethnic genocide. And still, America is not doing what we should be doing to stop it now that it's considered an ethnic genocide. And then the starvation in Yemen, South Sudan, Somalia, and Nigeria, they are in the drought for, I think it's now in its eighth year of being in a full drought, and then it's also caused famine, obviously, as all the crops have died. And 250,000 people have died in Somalia alone since the start of the drought, and half of those are children, just because of how much nutrition they need. And looking at that picture is just, it's hard to look at, and I, again, just don't know how your heart can't be stirred to try and fix those things. So I'm just going to move on to my specific things, because that was just a brief overview of where I kind of started looking at. So I don't have a stand for this yet, so I'm going to I'll hold it up.
Yeah, just hold it.
Explain. So I'm going to be careful, because the push pins went through the back of the board. Didn't know that was going to happen.
Yeah.
You definitely scratched my mom's hardwood floor.
You can tape. We'll tape the back of it.
Yeah. So this is the map I created, and
come closer.
I don't know, because I'd be out of the camera.
Okay, scoot over. Don't be out of camera.
Okay.
Right there is good.
So basically, this started my product. This is part of my product, and the other part is I'm creating 12 research papers. So for almost every pen, there's a research paper, just to do a super intensive look at the policy. And so as you can see, all the blue push pins our policy concerning the U.S., all the purple is policy concerning Russia, and all the green is the European Union, and all the pink is China. And so there's one less on China because looking at Chinese policy on refugees, they actually don't have any internal policy for refugee issues, which is really interesting to think about how many issues there are just with Myanmar. They actually support the Myanmar government in the ethnic genocide and the fact of they are still, almost every nation in the world has stopped giving any aid to the Myanmar government to give out, and instead they are sending aid workers in to specifically help the Rohingya people, but China is still funding the Myanmar government and backing the Myanmar government and hasn't done anything to, one, let any of the refugees in as they're so close that it would be very easy for them to, and also just hasn't given any money or food or supplies to help the people being displaced just for their ethnicity. And then also here is just what I briefly talked about with the Kashmir war. And then with Russia, we have, I was looking at the Ukrainian war and just how Russia's basically supporting both sides of the war so that if the country does end up splitting, they can try and take over part of it again, still just looking to expand their territory as much as they can, which is crazy to think about because of just looking at how much land they had when they were the Soviet Union, they're trying to expand back to what they were during that, which is a little scary for what could cause for how much power they have. And then here we have Tajikistan and Kazakhstan, which they're also in civil war, both of those countries, and Russia is actually funding to help in those civil wars. So they're sending tents, and they're sending money, and they're sending food to help any of the civilians that are affected by the war, which is really interesting considering how in Syria, which is the last one that I had for Syria, or for refugees, they've let in one Syrian refugee since the start of the Syrian civil war, which actually they've been funding the government's like battles and bomb drops, and their own plants have dropped, I think it was 16,000 bombs a year. I have it in my research paper. But it's just insane to see all the different policy they have for the different areas, specifically because Syria wasn't part of the Soviet Union when it was an item, but Tajikistan and Kazakhstan were. So they're trying to help them to maintain those positive ties so that if they were to ever expand again, they can include those territories. And then also, they continue the supporting the Syrian civil war because, one, they have a naval base in Syria, which is their last base outside of the former Soviet Union territory. So they're really holding tightly onto that. And they also see that if they lose that territory, it's basically a win for America. And we can start westernizing the world through Syria, which they don't want. And then moving on to the European Union. So here we just have the pen for Libya, because Libya is where most of the refugees are crossing the Mediterranean from, because it's very close to Italy and it's very close to Greece. And then what my research paper talks about how both Italy and Greece receive such a great influx of refugees seeking refugee status and seeking asylum status that it's too many for them to handle. They receive about, I think it's was 12,000 a month, and that it just gets too much for them. So a lot of refugees have tried to pass through the countries to move up to the more northern countries like Germany and Norway, because all of the countries that are in the European Union are required to give food, housing, clothes, and extra money for personal expenses, as well as medical aid to any person waiting their refugee status, even if they're going to get denied, which was really amazing for me to see, because no matter what happens, these people have been brave to leave their country to try and better themselves. And so the European Union is really trying to help them, like, entice people to leave what they're going through to just come and seek a better life. And so that was really interesting to look at, that they require them, no matter if they're going to be sent back home, to have a nice hot meal, a roof over their head, fresh clothes on them that are clean, as well as extra spending money for kids to go to the doctor, for parents to get glasses, whatever they need They also have language sessions where they just help integrate these refugees into society so that they can be most successful and just have a really nice quality of life. And then here is Somalia and just the East African area, that is just really in that drought and that famine, just how they've sent, I believe it's, they just signed a $20 million plan to send money, aid, clothes, aid workers, food, and fresh drinking water and water purification centers into East Africa so that they can help try and relieve that and to alleviate that. And they keep, I believe this is the third time they've renewed that bill, so it's the third time they've sent $20 million down there. And moving on to the U.S., we have Mexico, which this part wasn't in my slide, which is really interesting to talk about, is for the humanitarian crisis for the U.S., I'm actually looking at human trafficking, and not entirely just the sex slave sides of it, but just poor underpaid labor, because that's a piece that people don't really look at as much. When you think of human trafficking, you just automatically think of sex slaves and that sort of thing. And it's interesting to see that actually more people are brought in for free labor than sex slaves, which, again, that's not something I knew. It kind of just knocked me off my feet a little bit, because you just kind of assume these things and then you see something that's completely opposite and you get, it's just, words leave you, you know, But I have it in my notes right here that 18,000 people are brought into the U.S. every year illegally via human trafficking, and it is the third biggest international crime in the world. And here's Venezuela with the Venezuelan Civil War and just how the U.S. is trying to help, and then the U.S. also with Syria, and I did a big case study on the difference between the Obama administration and his last year in office. His ceiling for refugees from all over the world was 110,000 people. And then, obviously, when Trump came into office, he immediately stopped that, and he actually put an indefinite refugee ban on refugees from Syria, and then that was only in place for, I believe, 4 months, and then still had a total 3-month travel ban from any Middle Eastern country that is predominantly Muslim, which was interesting to look at how people of his own party didn't support him through those decisions, which was interesting of how his administration still let him pass that executive order, even though there was so much, there's not any support for it throughout the party, which I thought was interesting. And that's basically all of my project, or my product, and just, I have those different case studies written out. So I just want to thank you for coming and learning about international relations with me, and just learning about how different countries interact and try and help fix global issues, and seeing all that I've done this year. So thank you very much, and if there's any questions, I'd love to answer them to the best of my ability, and if I can't answer them, I'll try and find the answer and get back to you. Thank you.
All right, kiddo. We have lots to talk about.
Yeah, I know. I don't know.